Good day. Well, Rob did most of the introductions. I'm Marco, and I work for the Ripe NC, and I think most of you have seen me before. Usually I go on rambling about IPv6. Trust me, I did not have a choice. I was paid to do that. Talk about something else then. Things. Oh yeah, things are everywhere, right? That's cool. And so, where did I go? Hello? No. Play again. Really, modern technology in the morning. Huh, great. Okay, so where am I? Ah, there's things. Yes, things. And so is the internet. So, great. The internet of things. It's so easy, right? Just plug stuff in your house, you just plug it on the internet, and we're all good. Let me be very clear. I do believe in the internet of things. I mean, there's certainly something there. We can debate all about whether the name is correct and how much internet there actually is in the internet of things. Usually there's none, but still, I do believe we're onto something here. This could actually help us. This could improve things. Could also dramatically not improve things. It's somewhat dangerous. And I spend a lot of times in circles around the IoT and people talking about the IoT. And yes, you hear something about the benefits, what can it do to an aging society, what can we do in terms of, you know, carbon footprint and helping the environment along. But what most people talk about is security. And most of the security talks are actually sort of intertwined with privacy. The IoT is all about data, and that's actually as far as we came to it earlier discussions last year at Center workshop, how to define the Internet of Things. Well, we kind of came down, it's all about data, and that's actually where you see most of the stuff happening. It's all these things, all these sensors exist, the internet exists, it's more about collecting the data, processing the data, doing something useful with it. And everybody is really concerned about their privacy and what if you end up with the data? What if somebody ends up with your data? A lot of smart people, a lot of big people, and Jeff, I think you were still there when we sort of wrote this. You get things like politicians get interested, right? This is big. This is big enough that politicians get interested in it. And you end up in groups like the OECD, who wrote security guidelines, and I can tell you, and I can send you the link, it's all just basically common sense. But I love this quote, promoting the development of a culture of security, a focus of security in the development information systems and networks. Oh boy, those are nice words, right? I helped write them. Jeff was there as well. Lovely time in Paris. We have a solution, right? Back down to earth, down to earth, down to security in IT. What we all do on a daily basis. That won't happen to me. But seriously, that's kind of the response you always get when you talk with people about security. It's always somebody else. The Tuesday we had a discussion at the Dutch IGF, and then somebody, I think, hit the nail on that when he said, like, yeah, it's always somebody else's problem, and he's never in the room when we talk about it. That's how we deal with security. More smart quotes then. An SEP, that's really, it is somebody else's problem. Adams was right there. It's we don't see it, we don't want to see it. So yeah, security. What about security? Well, when I say security, most people think about this, right? You hand over your tube of toothpaste, you check in your laptops, you go to this fancy machine that show people behind the screens everything about you, and literally everything. You know, you just get bombarded with a few microwaves, and oh boy, do we feel safe, right? Yeah, what? We just all go to this system. I love it. Do it a lot. IT security actually is not that dissimilar from the thing I just shown you. We detect, we filter, we identify threats. No, you're not coming on board. Not with that, sir. Oh, we shoot that packet off. Try again later. That's IT security. Simple thing. So,
yeah, here we are. Everybody went through that security filter. You've got 500 people on an airplane feeling all very secure. And this happens. All of a sudden, mid-Atlantic, your stage one fan comes off. Oops. Houston, we have a problem. Or Paris in this case. Actually, the good thing is nothing happened here. It's got four engines, right? We love redundancy. So even though the engine came apart, you just land, and then the biggest problem was that allegedly Goose Bay did not have a ladder long enough to reach an A380, so they had to wait for somebody to drive over a taller aircraft stairs. This is quite a big incident. Now, think about how airlines would handle that. You know, okay, so the thing ends up, the aircraft operator, Air France, Airbus, the engine manufacturer, the authorities, everybody goes along and starts figuring out, what the hell happened here? Is this really an incident, or is this a more structural problem? How safe are the other engines on the other A380s, etc.? Think about how we would handle something like this in our world, in our industry. Have you tried turning it off and on again? That stage one fan might magically just reappear, just reboot, you know? Just start it up again. Oh, here, it's good again. And, you need an upgrade. Yeah, sorry, your engine came apart. You just buy a bigger engine. And please don't tweet about it. Come on, I took this picture from Twitter. Oh, boy. Just imagine that somebody in the IT would do that. You're sued to kingdom come. Don't you ever dare talk about it. Here's some money, shut up. That's how we handle incidents in IT. Kind of on the quoting tour this morning. This had Murphy's Law here, but it's kind of boring. I came across this one from Goethe. It's kind of saying the same thing. You know, but think about it. Something can go wrong, sure. And as he describes, it's sort of the neglect and the misunderstanding that's much more often the cause of security incidents in the IT than it actually is malice. I'm gonna show you an example in a bit, but kind of thought for this is, what about our safety culture? As they generally call it. In the airlines, it's called crew resource management. Something similar happens in the offshore industry. It's now getting hold, especially in US healthcare, where they call it just culture. It's all about the same. It's all about making sure that if a mistake happens, you're not at fault, as long as you make sure the mistake doesn't happen again. The punitive part, the really damaging part, where people will get fired and where people will get sued, is simple neglect. It's basically protecting not only yourself, but protecting your customers. So back to the flight deck. What can we learn then? Because the aircraft industry really sort of were pioneering. They invented this whole system, that system of speak up. If you do see something wrong, speak up, talk about it, correct the problem. And I've got one example here, and to the untrained eye, this looks really complicated. This primary flight display. Forget about people looking out of the window, right? When they're flying, you're up in the air, all you see is blue and gray. This is basically all the guy looks at in flying. And I took these two examples, Airbus and Boeing, and to the untrained eye, they look quite different until you sort of start seeing what is actually there. Because to the left, you have the speed. To the right, you've got the altitude, the climb rate. Both of them are descending, I think. Yes, both of them are descending. In the bottom, you sort of got a compass. Where are you heading? You've got the horizon. Everything is largely in the same place. It looks tiny different, a bit of different color, but basically, once you understand that Airbus PFD, it's a very quick step to Boeing. This makes sense. It's all common sense if you look at it. Here's a typical IT solution. Took this example. This is my phone. Oh no, wait. This was my phone because I upgraded it. And since last week, this is my phone. it's roughly the same, right? Few buttons change, few fields change. And once I know how to configure my phone, of course configuring my laptop is really easy, right? This is the same manufacturing, same Apple. Once I know my phone, I'm easy good with my laptop, or vice versa. Now, I kind of skipped a few slides and skipped a few pictures, but I can tell you that once you understand the fly deck of an Airbus A318, the smallest one they do, you can kind of also fly an A380. It's a much larger aircraft, but everything is simply in the same spot. Every button, every knob works the same. Type rating, upgrading between small aircraft, big aircraft, makes it really easy. And we kind of, in our industry, do the same, right? Once you know how to switch on your computer, you can configure your phone. You're a system administrator, right? We give you the server. Because it's all so easy. We really, you know what you're doing. You've got a laptop, you manage to switch it on and hook it up to the internet. For sure, you're a system administrator. Well, I cheated a bit here. This is the BSD installer. This has nothing to do with Apple OS 10, right? No. Let me get it straight. There's nothing wrong here. I mean, the internet's still ticking. My laptop still works. What? Is there any room for improvement here? I don't know. Maybe. And think about your own interfaces. You probably do the same. Oh, yeah. Marketing comes up. Let's do a new website. And all the buttons and all the forms change and everything is in a different place. Oh boy. Oh there. Actually, the biggest thing in the aircraft industry, like I said, is actually learning from your incidents. These reports are all public. I'm dying to read that thing. It probably takes 3 to 6 months. Now you'll probably find a big, lengthy report on what exactly happened to that engine. And I'm curious and I like aircraft, so I'm probably going to read it just to figure out what happened there, which bolt failed, or what was the manufacturing problem that caused that central hub of that fan cowling to come apart. It's really interesting. I studied material science in the past. It's also really interesting. But let me get it straight. Finding who did it remains important. Maybe there was somebody who actually walked up to that aircraft with a big hammer and sort of smashed it into the fan cowling. Or maybe it hit a bird. And it took a while before things came apart. Nobody actually knows. But we'll find out. We can all read it. We can all learn from that. Honest mistake, malicious activity, or just simply bad luck. The jury is still out on that. But that part, the disclosure and analysis, I think is very important. And how much of that do we actually do in our industry when things go wrong? Shove it under the carpet. Nothing to see here. Go along. Yeah, now it's only 50 million accounts that were hacked. Oh, it's only 100 million. Now half a million. And you sold the company. Oh, it was actually all accounts. Oh. Somebody still got rich there. That's how we deal with it. And don't you dare go on a stage at a conference and talk about it. That's the end of your career. Trust me. Incidents are very rarely caused by just one individual. And that's kind of the core of that whole safety culture in aircraft, and that's kind of the core of that just culture in healthcare. It's not one individual. It's usually the whole chain, the whole system that let small things slip. And when they all kind of align and when they all come together, that's where really big incidents happen. Yeah, I'll quickly fix that. Here's a quick patch. Here's just temporary password. But if you don't make sure that person changes that temporary password, whose fault is it when things go wrong? You? Him? Or shall we just blame the software manufacturer for allowing you to set that stupid password in the first place? Analyze, learn, and improve. Think about it. How much of that do you actually do? How often do you just go and flip the switch off on again. Yeah, that solves the problem. Happens again, yeah? Who here actually sort of like, yeah, memory leak? Ah, we'll just reboot the system. We'll set the crunch up every week. Doesn't it sound vaguely familiar? So here's my thought, and I kind of thinking about it, maybe it's also a challenge for today, because security is a really big thing. No doubt somebody's going to mention security today. Try and rephrase that. Try and talk about safety. This is not something out to get you. Yeah, maybe. But what if you really look into analysis, and what if you really try to solve the problem at the root cause? That's kind of where I want to leave it. I'm happy to talk more about this. This is something that's just sort of starting, I think, at least for me. But really, think about how we handle our incidents in our industry. And then think about what we're actually flocking out to our customers. And then think about what is going to happen with the IoT, where your smart meter is actually a really dumb switch, and a really insecure switch. I don't know how we do with timing. I'm happy to take some questions, comments. Feel free to throw a few bottles or stones at me. I know it's still early, but why not? Happy to hear your thoughts. Am I completely off here?
No. So we are very good for time. So if anyone has any questions for Marco.
Yeah, we'll just switch it and on it. Want to do your pitch about spectrum, Jeff? I think we have a bit of a problem here, but yeah.
Hi, Michael Abramson. So I saw a talk about this on the Chaos Computer Club meeting, five, 8 years ago. They were talking about how they do code for aircraft systems. It was 100 lines of code per programmer per day. You were not allowed to write more than that. Several people check the code afterwards and so on. That doesn't really do the same thing as the whole DevOps thing that's all the craze and agile development and all of that. So that's an interesting thing to try to work together, because if you need that kind of resiliency and working together, it becomes really expensive really quickly. And that's not the way we have done things historically. So yeah, I agree, this is a pretty big change. So that was not a question, that was a statement.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. This if you really want to do this proper, it's going to get expensive. And then everybody complains like, oh, my margins are under pressure, I can't afford that. Ever looked into the books of a major airline? None of them is making any money. But at least we didn't crash flying here. Sucks to be them, but at least I'm safe. I feel much safer. Would you actually get into that aircraft if you know the code that's flying it was written by one of your colleagues? Would you get in that aircraft if it was code written by you?
No.
It's always somebody else's problem, right?
Any questions from
Mark? Okay, I'm gonna switch off and hand you the mic then, Rob.
Okay. Well, can join me in thanking Mark.
Cheers.